Thank you for that introduction. And it's my pleasure to be here today and to have the honor to talk to you about advances we've seen in the diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease, whether this has implications for clinical practice. There are many, many people worldwide with Alzheimer's disease or another type of dementia. And this disorder comes with huge costs, both financially, but also emotionally, socially. And in addition to that, there's a huge caregiver burden, because it takes a lot of energy and a lot of time to care for a person with dementia. And this is why we can call Alzheimer's disease and dementia one of the grand challenges in healthcare of our time. We have to come up as a society, as researchers, policymakers, as people with dementia or without dementia. We have to come up with solutions. We have to find treatment and to make sure that we arrange care as optimally as we can. And I take as a starting point that a timely and accurate diagnosis is essential to allow choices, arrange proper care, choose medication, and prevent crises later on in the disease process, and perhaps delay nursing home admittance, for example. And I think that when we look back on the past decades, the research that has been performed, that advances in the research and the knowledge on novel options for diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease are among the largest advances in the field. We've really learned a lot. We are able now to diagnose Alzheimer's disease in the living brain. We can use MRI, brain picture, where we can depict atrophy, shrinkage of the brain, globally, global brain, the whole brain, but also of specific areas of the brain that are particularly relevant for memory, such as the hippocampus. In the cerebrospinal fluid, we can measure concentrations of both amyloid and tau, the two Alzheimer proteins. And while that was a very large improvement, because now we were able to actually measure amyloid pathology, Alzheimer's pathology in living patients, we could still not see it in a concentration. But we're now also able to visualize Alzheimer pathology in living patients using a PET scan, as you see down in the lower panel on this slide. We can use amyloid PET. So what this has learned us, that we can actually measure Alzheimer's pathology during life. And this allows for an accurate diagnosis. But this has also meant that we can actually show this Alzheimer pathology before somebody becomes in the stage of dementia. For example, in the stage of mild cognitive impairment. And we also see when we look at memory clinics throughout the world that the number, the proportion of patients in the very early stages of the disease, so the proportion of patients with mild cognitive impairment, is growing. So if you would have a memory complaint, you would be worried about your memory, you would be referred by a general practitioner to one of the memory clinics. And in our little country, the Netherlands, we have over 100 of these memory clinics. And this is what the patient journey would then look like. So you would get a diagnostic workup. The clinician, the doctor, would choose which tests to perform or not to perform. Are there additional tests needed, such as MRI or CSF or PET? Then the doctor will interpret the results, communicate what's found, and then come to a diagnosis and patient management plan. All very clear and simple, or not. Because how do you decide which test to use, and in which order, and in which stage of the disease? So if I choose to use MRI, for example, what's the best application? Can I just look visually at it, or do I need a complicated software package to measure in much detail what the volume of the brain is? What's the best application? What if there's more than one test? How do I combine the results? What if one test says it fits Alzheimer's, but the other says it does not? How to combine that? What about the patient? What does the patient think? All too often, we actually forget to ask this question. And what does this result mean for my patient? So a lot of results come from research which is always based on groups of patients and groups of controls, but there's never an average sitting before you. It's always an individual. So what does it mean for this patient? And once I know what I found, what the test result was, how do I explain this to the patient and carer sitting before me? So in this talk, I would like to tell you of two of the studies that I'm involved in. And the first one is the ABIDE study, and ABIDE stands for Alzheimer Biomarkers in Daily Practice. And the overarching goal of this study is to translate the knowledge that's available to us from research about MRI, CSF, and PET, about these diagnostic tests. How can we translate this to daily clinical practice? And ABIDE is executed by a public-private consortium, and it has a special focus on the early stages of dementia, such as MCI, mild cognitive impairment. We have explicit involvement of local professionals. We don't want this to be an academic exercise only, and we have explicit involvement of patients and caregivers. And here you see the goals that ABIDE works on. So we want to improve this patient journey by focusing before the diagnostic test, creating algorithms on how to choose a test, but also involve patients in making this choice. Then optimally use the test, develop what are the best applications, and how can we then interpret these data and get results from it that are relevant for the individual patient, and how do we communicate these results in the optimal and most optimal way to our patients. The second study that I will be talking about is the PREDICT-ND study, which is a European study which has been funded in the context of the FP7 framework. And its goal is to develop computer-based tools to support clinicians when they try to make a diagnosis of neurodegenerative diseases. This is also a public-private consortium which focuses on different types of dementia, such as differential diagnosis. We combine clinical and technical knowledge, and there's prominent involvement of Alzheimer Europe as the voice of patients and caregivers. And here I would like to focus on three of the questions. So that's not all there is to say about diagnosis, because I could easily talk for 2 hours about this subject, but I will focus on three questions. And the first is, what does the patient want? When we think about diagnostic workup, about what tests should be done, and also how should these results be communicated? And here we actually talk about shared decision-making. Shared decision-making is a concept that means that doctors and patients and their carers work together to decide which care plan best fits their needs. And this is relevant when there's more than one reasonable option to choose from. And shared decision-making takes as an assumption that the doctor is the expert on the disease, but the patient and the carer are really the experts on the individual disease process and also on what's relevant for them. And on the right panel, you see that the shared decision-making has a number of steps. It begins with creating choice awareness. There's more than one reasonable option. And then we have to inform the patient about these different options there are to choose from. Explore preferences together. What's important for this patient, for this family, and finally make a decision. So what about shared decision-making in the context of dementia diagnosis? Because there are more than one reasonable options, especially now that we get more and more diagnostic tests that we can use. We can choose to have a diagnosis, or not a diagnosis at all. Once we decide to have a diagnosis, we can say we want a general diagnosis, just a thorough talk with the doctor and anamnesis is sufficient. Or you can say, no, I want specifically to know what's wrong with me, what's happening in my brain. I want many tests. And finally, how should these results be communicated? What does the patient expect from this diagnosis? What do you need to hear? What do you want to hear? So we do have to manage the expectations. So we ask patients and carers in a number of roundtable conversations in a number of hospitals across the Netherlands. And here you see a photo of one of these roundtable conversations. And the patients said they felt involved in the decision whether to initiate diagnostic testing. But once this decision had been made, they did not feel so much involved in which test was performed and why. and they wanted to have more specific information about these tests. What could they learn from them? And what did they learn from them? What did it say in their case? And also they wanted more information about what the results meant for their personal lives. For example, did they have prognostic value? So then, we also wanted to know, what do the doctors think about shared decision-making in the context of dementia diagnosis? And we asked the Dutch doctors of the over 100 memory clinics, and over 100 doctors, geriatricians, neurologists, answered our questionnaire. And in addition to the questionnaire, we also had a roundtable conversation with a number of these neurologists and geriatricians. And the physicians, they said, they feel they involve the patient's decision making. They say we do always involve them in decision making. That's our job. But when we asked further questions, it turned out that this refers mostly to providing information. So that's step 2 out of 4 steps in shared decision making. So there was not so much involvement of making clear that there are more than one options and exploring the advantages and disadvantages of the different options and choosing together. So not the other steps in shared decision making. And we also noticed that there's large practice variation amongst the clinicians. So what we conclude is that there seems to be room for improvement when we talk about shared decision making in dementia diagnosis, particularly in the way we communicate about the choices, but also about the conveyance of the results, the disclosure. So as a next step, we went into the consulting room and actually listened to what's happening over there. In 10 hospitals throughout the Netherlands, we consulted over 130 patient-doctor encounters, and we're currently analyzing these data. And I hope, for example, next year or the year after, to share the results with you of what's actually happening in the consulting room, and we hope that we can use these results to make recommendations to further improve communicating about dementia diagnosis. So then, the second topic, how to combine all these results. So in most memory clinics, there's a number of tests being done to come to a diagnosis of dementia. This may be neuropsychological testing, CSF taking, or MRI. And how do we come to a diagnosis and patient management plan from there? And for this, I turn to the PREDICT-ND project. So the challenge for the clinician, and here you see my colleague Hanneke Rodius, who has done a lot of work for this project, is how to weigh and combine all the available data, especially when results are conflicting or incomplete. And also knowing that, in fact, in many of patients do not behave like the textbook. Because, for example, there's mixed disease, they suffer from more than one type of dementia. So could a computer tool help? And this is what we have studied in the PREDICT-ND project. So the PREDICT-ND tool is a tool to aid diagnostic decision making, to support the clinician in diagnostic decision making. It's trained on a large data set of both patients and controls, and then visualizes how the data of one individual compare to either the patients or the controls. And this is what it looks like, and would like to zoom in on this, what we call the disease fingerprint, that combines all the data of one patient in one listing. You see listed all the different tests with a box before it. And every box has both a size, which illustrates how important this particular test is for the diagnosis, and a color. And the color denotes how much this test points to either control or dementia, Alzheimer's or another type of dementia. And this makes it feasible for a clinician to, with one look at the screen, see how all the data combined together look. So this computer tool provides an overview of data. It doesn't change the diagnostic process, but we hope it may facilitate interpretation of results. As a next step, we're currently prospectively validating this tool. We've been using it in the clinic, in 4 different clinics across Europe, and have collected data of over 800 patients. And we try to understand whether we can use this approach to distinguish between different types of dementia. And the first results look quite favorable. As the last project that I would like to share with you is about individual risk prediction. So if the diagnosis in a memory clinic is not dementia, but mild cognitive impairment, then we're not talking about a diagnosis, because MCI is not a diagnosis. We're talking about prognosis. What's the risk that you will have dementia in the future? And here we took our cohort of MCI patients from the Amsterdam Dementia Cohort as a starting point, and we had over 500 patients with MRI and or CSF data available. We took into account patient-specific age and gender and severity of cognitive impairment, which we measured with the MMSE. And here in the grey, perhaps it's very light on the background, you see the groups. There was a group of patients who progressed to Alzheimer's dementia and a group who remained stable. And when we compare these groups, we see that older patients are more likely to progress, patients with worse cognition are more likely to progress, patients who have atrophy and patients who have abnormal CSF biomarker are more likely to show progression to dementia over time. But this is on group level, and this has been shown by many studies. What should you tell the next patient who comes into your office? And here, we hooked up with our Department of Statistics and Epidemiology, and we did some really heavy statistical modeling. And we came up with this, and it's about the graphs. And what it is that it helps to interpret the prognosis of this individual's probability of having dementia in the future. So what we can do, if we have this female with MCI, she's 60 years old and her MMSE is 24, then if we know nothing else, this MCI patient would have 16% probability to have dementia in 1 year, 58% probability of dementia in 3 years. But now we add the data from MRI and CSF, and we find that she has moderate, which is quite some atrophy on MRI, and her CSF is normal. And now we look at the graphs on the right, and you see on the y-axis there's the amyloid beta, and on the x-axis there's the tau. So there's the two Alzheimer proteins that we can learn from CSF. And then in the three panels, you see three different levels of atrophy, severe atrophy or moderate atrophy, mild atrophy, no atrophy. Now, if we look up this patient, we can see that she's really in the green zone. So actually the risk that was 16% in 1 year becomes now 2% in 1 year. And the risk that was 58% after 3 years is now reduced to only 15% after 3 years. So the risk model allows the clinician to have individualized prognosis for a patient sitting right at his desk, at her desk. And what we see here is that we always think about the biomarkers to actually demonstrate that the disease is there, that you have a high risk. But in fact, the biomarkers especially have value in the pre-dementia stages when they're normal, because then we can use them to reassure patients that they should not be worried. So this is a much more precise answer than if we had not known these biomarkers. So the next step is, this statistical modeling is nice, this graphical representation is nice, but it's not really that easy to understand. So how to develop a tool to support communication. And this is what we're actually doing in the ABIDE project. And this tool is going to be called the ADAPT. And this is work in progress. The tool is not there yet. You cannot look it up on the internet yet, but we hope it will be there soon. And the tool actually at this moment is intended to have three functions. First, to support doctors and patients and carers in the shared decision-making conversation. So it will have information about the different diagnostic tests, about the advantages, the disadvantages, and it will also support the doctor in going through the different steps of shared decision making. Then we will have in the tool the risk models, but not as a difficult to understand calculator. It's very simple to use app. You can fill in the patient's characteristics and the patient's values on his biomarkers, and then we have a risk if we did not know the biomarkers, and we can see how the probability of dementia changes when we do know, when we do add the biomarker information. And this should be very easy to use for a clinician in daily clinical practice. Very concrete results of this research into diagnosis. And finally, even when this is very helpful for the clinician, it's not really the best way to convey these results to the patient. And therefore, we will have another function as well that will help the clinician to convey, to disclose the results in a meaningful way to the patient, to explain what's been found and what does it mean for the patient. How should you interpret this? And the next step that we will be doing, we're now finalizing this tool, and we will do that in a pilot study in a small number of Dutch hospitals to see how the tool can be used in clinical practice. And based on the results we will get from this pilot study, we will then ramp up and use an improved version of the tool in a larger number of hospitals in the Netherlands. And of course, we also hope there will be a translation so other countries can use the tool as well. And with that, I come at the end of my talk. I've said that improved diagnosis is among the largest successes of dementia research. When people say we don't know anything yet, that's in fact not true, because we have come from a far way, we come from a far distance, and in fact we've made really huge steps and are able now to make a good diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease and hopefully also of other types of dementia, although that's still a bit more difficult. But almost all research which is there is based on a group level, and we do need to bridge the gap between science and clinical practice in everyday. Second, I've shown you that there's room for shared decision making. We should listen to the patient, especially in this era when there's more and more options when you talk about diagnosis. So whether or not to test and how specific tests, which tests would a patient want? We have to manage expectations. What can you learn from a test? And also, what can you not learn from them? Because there will still be uncertainty, even if we do all the tests. And we should improve the disclosure or the explanation of what has been found and what this means for the patient. And I think that e-tools, in this era of technology and iPhones and iPads, e-tools can also help in daily medical practice, to integrate available data, but also to interpret data for the individual patient and to support communication with the patient. And I think this is all of great relevance today, because a good diagnosis, an accurate diagnosis, is a starting point to arrange optimal care. But especially tomorrow, when I hope that someday there will be treatments that actually stop or even prevent the disease. And then it will be even more relevant to have these tools in place to discover who has and who is not at risk of developing Alzheimer's dementia within a couple of years. And with that, I would like to end this presentation, but not before thanking everybody at the Alzheimer Center in Amsterdam and also all project partners of both the ABIDE and the PREDICT-ND projects. Thank you.